Today I'm going to talk about memories. Sometimes I think I should do this the very first day of the class, because really all of college, if you think about it, is just memory. Can you remember the things you And so memory goes back to the neural network, neurons. Memories are just electrical impulses that are firing in our brain. These patterns that we have, our pathways of neurons are. And so if you think about these pathways right here, we have this electrical system all throughout our body, but especially in our brain. And one of the things I like to think about is this. I stole this from Joe Dispenza, and I'll show him in just a minute. Anyway, he says the pathway in the brain is kind of like a path in the grass. You've worn it through, especially a strong pathway. And so if you think about a nerve like this or a pathway of neurons. So that's good if it's a good pathway, but I struggle because I was struggling with it this morning. The Tim is a piece of shit pathway. So I've worn that thing out. It's really, really big. And so my natural tendency is to go onto the big pathways I've created in my mind. Are y'all with me so far? And that pathway is not going to go away until I walk a new path in the grass. And at first, this new path in the grass might spring back up. I won't go all the way down to the dirt. I didn't do it this way. But eventually, if I walk along this new path, Tim is a good person, Tim is a good person, and this is my mantra. I don't want to go Joel Osteen right now, but you can't set your mind on autopilot. That this would grow back over, and that this would be the natural tendency of my brain without medication. Okay, and so this is muscle memory. If there's muscle memory for all kinds of other things, hiking, working out, skiing, why wouldn't there be muscle memory for the thoughts that I have in my mind? What Joel Osteen says is you thought yourself into this, you can think yourself out of it. Okay, and Joe Dispenza says this, every time we have a thought, we make a chemical. Like good thoughts make dopamine. They just do. You know what I mean? Bad thoughts make like cortisol and other things. And so if we keep reinforcing those bad thoughts, we're making our own drugs in our mind. He says we can mold and shape our brain by paying attention. If we pay attention to an idea, we begin to wire and shape our brain, which means I can rewire my brain. I hope you understood that part. I really love it. Okay, as far as the test and memory, there's three things: encoding, storage, and retrieval. Encoding is how you put it in. Okay, so I didn't know all of them were going to pop up like that on me. So on a computer, how do I enter it? Right? I could scan it, all kinds of other ways. Storage is where you're going to put it. I'm big on this because if you're good at storage, then retrieval becomes a snap. Okay, I'm OCD boy, and usually that works to my disadvantage, but I got a PhD because I'm OCD, and so I'm good at organizing information. I'm going to talk about this for just a second, how you store things so that you can go and get them in a good fashion. Okay, think of your mind like a hall closet right here. If I just jam everything into the closet, when it comes test time for retrieval, it's going to be really hard for me to find it. It's in here, all right, but I might not find it because it's so cluttered. Now, you're talking to the wrong person because I'm Mr. OCD boy. Now, one of the first things I want to talk about is this, schemas. Schemas are these folders that help us organize our head. So you go, how can I have folders in my head? Like one time I was telling my mom, I was like, oh, just click onto the window. And she goes, I don't have no window on my computer. It's like, okay, it's not a literal window. You know what I mean? Just show me a literal folder on your computer. We have folders on there. They're electronic folders that help us organize information. Okay, so I have these folders that help me kind of divide and organize the world. Sometimes I don't like folders, and if you take my gender class, I'll go off on the folders that we use the most, boy versus girl. Because I love transgender people, and I especially love genderqueer people that just say, fuck the folder, okay? But we're not in my gender class. That's for. Okay, we have the H drive at school, but most people have the C drive, right? If I just jam everything into the C drive, all the files and things I've ever created, it's going to be hard for me to go find them. I'm Mr. OCD boy, so I have all these folders within folders within folders. You can't see these over here, but On my home computer, I have personal stuff, but everything for school, which is more important. Then I teach five different classes, and then within each class, I have exams. I don't want to write all this out. Overheads, whatever, this, that, and the other, all these different materials. Okay, so including a folder called grades. And so if you told me 3 years ago I took your class and I want to see my grades, I'd just go right there. In 2 seconds, I would find it because of not only the folders, but the naming conventions. Now, this leads to my first example is this. They ask people to remember these 16 animals. When they take them away, people weren't very good at remembering 16. Let's say on average, they remembered, I don't know, 4 out of 16, 25%. I'm just making that up. Another group of people, they ask it this way. I should go look at this original study. They ask them to use these folders. I want you to think about that these 16 animals could be either tame cats or wild cats, tame dogs or wild dogs. Now, these are the folders. Now, when they stack the 16 animals this way and take them away, the memory test goes way up. Let's say they remember at least 50 or 60%. Half of them could be guesses. A wild dog. I'm just going to guess wolf and coyote. Well, there you go. You know what I mean? You got like 2 out of 16 right there. Wild cat, lion, and tiger. Okay. Four. You're already 25% of the way there just with the folders. Hopefully, you follow my drift. Okay. So, the other thing I wanted to talk about before I go on to the three kinds of memory is spreading activation. Spreading activation is this weird theory because one time I was teaching and people were going, "Oh, you got all these nice, neat little folders. Didn't you think, say, your mind was like a choppy ocean?" It's like, yeah. It's like, and it is. If I say red, maybe that sparks the folder of color over here, or it could spark a different folder, sky. It's like, okay, this is a color folder and a sky folder. And it's like if it sparked a sky, it's like, oh yeah, the sunset can be red. And I was thinking about clouds, and when I hike, I look at the clouds, and when I hike, I see rattlesnakes. Why am I thinking around rattlesnakes? It's like I'm supposed to be thinking about red, and I can be thinking roses are red and violets are blue, and violets are flowers, and I'm in the flower folder. And irises, didn't we talk about the iris? It's the stargate. Why am I talking about the stargate? I'm supposed to be talking about red. You get the drift. My mind can jump to all these different like folders. Brilliance of our mind, if you think about it, that is like God has created all these folders that can interconnect in disparate ways, and it allows for new connections. This is why I like mashups. It's like, how can people figure out that Black Sabbath goes with Tammy Wynette at the same time? But it's these creative connections that human beings make. Now, the rest of the lecture is going to be based on Atkinson and Shiffrin's model. You don't have to remember these people's name. It's like, but they just break the memories into three different storage areas. So we're going to talk about storage and how you store the first one in sensory memory. I like talking about this, but it's very brief and most of the time it's not as useful. Short-term memory here is our working memory, so I'll spend a lot of time here and even more time here because long-term memory is where we want to push things most of the time. Okay, if you look at it this way, sensory memory is kind of like a snapshot memory. Like if you close your eyes and try to imagine the way the room was, you can visualize it, but the visualization will start to creep away from you. Okay, and I'm going to talk about this in just a second. Okay, but if I pay attention to a certain component of the room, like if you told me your phone number and I didn't have a pen and pencil, but I just like try to focus on it and just say it over and over and over to myself, that's that short-term memory, working memory. But if I get distracted, it's going to go out of my head. I want to put that into long-term memory. I forgot I had the phone on here. And so if I push it to long-term memory, I can always go and access it, just like I have my parents' or my grandma's number memorized. Okay, so I'm going to talk about these three buckets that we put memories into, and the first one is going to be called sensory. So before I get there, I just like to go into this computer analogy. Computer is kind of based on us, and I might have mentioned this before, a neuron. Well, you say, well, what's a neuron on a computer? It's called on or off. It's called a bit. a bit right here can be on or off, and there's 8 bits in a byte, and we store information in bytes, and every single thing stored on a computer, including what I'm doing right now, is a combination of zeros and ones, just like you are. Booyah! I love this because there's this area of psychology and mathematics and biology that all come together at one place. This is where consciousness is going. Okay, enough about talking. The first kind. I called it snapshot memory because I really focus on vision because I'm an artist. I try to remember the way things looked, but I can only retain that impression if I look at a tree and close my eyes and then try to paint it for so long. For a while, it'll last for me, but I'm visual based. If you're a musician, it might be like you have an ear for stuff like this. Just think about it as a little kid. You don't have to have done drugs to see tracers. If you wave around a sparkler, you see where it's been. It's no longer there. You're just, seeing the after image of where it's been. Okay. I think I have this on here. There's two kinds of sensory memory, and I already mentioned both of them. Iconic, but icon is something you punch on the computer like a little picture, so visual snapshot. But you also have echoic, and if you're a musician, like I was hearing this one girl's like she was going to try out and she did like cello or violin. She said, in some of these tryouts, they just play a song for you, you listen to it, and then you have to come back in and play it right then by ear. You're just like, dude, I couldn't remember something like that, but that's that echoic memory. If you think about it, movies work on the principle of iconic memory. They don't really move. There's these still images that are flashed before your eyes so fast that by the time image one starts to fade, it bleeds into image two, which bleeds into image three, giving the illusion of movement. Okay, if we were in class, I'd show a bunch of movies about that part, but what I really want to do is show a movie about this guy, Stephen Wiltshire. He's awesome. I don't know. I like to show all these people that have disorders because God didn't fuck up when he made Stephen. Just like the guy with Asperger's that was a sober raver. I didn't show you Cody Lee on the first day of class that has he's blind and has autism. He was on America's Got Talent. But anyway, Stephen, what they do is they're gonna fly him above Rome. This is my favorite one, but they fly him above all these different cities like New York City or places in Dubai. But they give him like 30 or 45 minute helicopter ride, and the resolution's not the best, but I love showing this. And then they sit him for 3 days in this room with 15 feet of paper, and he has to recreate the whole thing. And he does the whole thing by memory because, see, it doesn't fade out of his head like it fades out of my head. It just stays in there. And so I'm fixing to show the video. Like I said, the resolution's not great, but this guy is amazing, and you can go and look him up online.
Stephen Wiltshire from London is a star among savants. His nickname is the Living Camera. Stephen is autistic. He lives in a world of his own. Communication is difficult for him. He didn't speak his first words, pencil and paper, until he was 5. Yet when he was 11, he drew a perfect aerial view of London after only one helicopter ride. Even the number of windows in all the major buildings in his drawing was correct. For this film, we're testing the living camera in Rome. Stephen has never seen the eternal city from above before. After only a 45-minute helicopter flight, we'll ask him to draw a 5.5-yard panoramic picture of the historic city center without having a second glance at it. Stephen has 3 days. In these 3 days, Stephen will have to keep thousands of details in his head. The innumerable cupolas, the tiny winding streets, all the balconies and windows of the endless array of houses, and each and every column and window arch of Rome's major sites, from the Pantheon to St. Peter's to the Colosseum. Stephen has never trained for this feat of magic. The miracle simply happened when he first started to draw. Yet none of us would have bet that Stephen would be able to draw Rome just from memory. 5.5 yards of paper can look scarily empty. The amazing thing Stephen starts the drawing as we would, with the Church of St. Peter's. But he doesn't do any sketches, nor roughing out of the space for the drawing. It's as if the panorama already existed within his head, with all the proportions, all the roads, all the details. A little miracle. At the end of the second day, Stephen is a good halfway through his creation. After 3 days of his drawing marathon, even Stephen Wiltshire starts to tire. He has filled in more than 5 yards of paper in fine pencil. He has been restlessly aligning window to window and house to house, because Stephen loves to be applauded for his art. In the left corner, he's finally reached the ruins of the Forum Romanum. Stephen's sister Annette is rejoicing with him. He's made it. Obviously, he's pleased with his work. Yet our vexing question still remains. How precise was Stephen's ability to memorize? Is it really true that you could only see a single curve of the Tiber from above? We started to compare the accuracy of the drawing with the real thing. Is Stephen's version of St. Peter's cupola too dominant? Yet here again, like with the curve of the Tiber, Stephen is frighteningly right. We wondered if the famous Roman hill should probably stand out more in Stephen's panorama. But again, Stephen had seen it better. From 1,000 feet up, the hills are, optically, almost level. Checking the Pantheon, we did discover some minor inaccuracies on the roof. But the number of columns of the portal is, again, absolutely correct. And, despite our doubts, Stephen has drawn one of the most complex buildings, the Colosseum, so precisely, it's practically a blueprint of reality. Stephen was also accurate in the instances we checked of nameless buildings and side streets. Had he had more time, his sister Annette believes, he would have put in even more detail.
Some of them areas of all of that park, lots of detail, remembered things of the some of the cities and the neighborhoods and the villages. And then the easy part is St. Peter's and Forum and the Colosseum, and memorize it by head and that, and by memory.
Okay, enough about sensory memory. The second storage area, which is really more important, is short-term memory. This is also known as working memory. See, sensory memory is over here, iconic, echoic, and working memory is where we're trying to like keep things in our head temporarily. On a computer, this would be RAM. And so maintenance rehearsal. This is the way we keep things into our short-term memory. What does that mean? We repeat them over and over and over. That is one way you can study for the test. Dendrite is the receiver. Axon, you know what I mean? Like you can just say it over and over and over. I argue this isn't the best way to study for the test, but a lot of times I study like this too. I just say people's names. I usually memorize everybody's name in class. I just have to say it over and over and over. Okay, so George Miller says when you do this technique of maintenance rehearsal, repeating things, you can only hold about 7 things in your head, give or take a few. Now, I don't know why he titled his book 7 plus or minus 2. Why didn't he go as many as 9? are as few as five. If you can hold five, you can hold zero. So from, you know what I mean? It just doesn't make sense, but 7 ± 2 is the name of his book. So if you go onto the internet and type in 7 ± 2, I think there's a lot of tests where they'll show you a list of words or something, and you're supposed to remember as many as you can in around 7. Okay, what's around 7 that we have to remember? Phone numbers. I mean, you could even include the area code, but why'd they make Social Security number only 9 and not 10 on purpose? Passwords for computers are 8, right? So, that seems to limit us. Look at this big number. It's like, how am I going to remember that? Now, this is the most important thing I think I could ever teach you in class. I know I say this a lot, but really it's this right here. Because a lot of people study like this. When I look at their notes, it's just jammed all the fuck together. It's like, dude, why don't you use some white space there, buddy? Because if you break that up, it'll be easier to eat. And the reason I have a sandwich on here is on purpose. Forgot I had it on here. One day I made a big sandwich, just set it on a plate, you know, I went to go do something, I think I was painting or something, and Rowdy, my dog, jammed the whole fucking thing into his throat at one time, almost choked. I thought I was going to have to take him to a vet. It's like, if you die off of this, you jerk, it's like you ate my sandwich and now you're going to choke, how about take a few bites if you're going to eat my sandwich? And I argue this with people, that you should break this up. If you break it up, you'll remember it. This is what the moral of the story is for the test. Don't make your notes a run-on sentence. And so chunking, I don't like this name because it reminds me of like barfing or something. I call it making it into baby piles. That might seem gayish, but that's who I am, gayish. And so I put it into little baby piles and they're easier to eat. Tame cats and wild dogs instead of 16 things in a row. Now, if I chunk things, I can remember them easier. One of the things I have down here is a credit card number. I made this one up. Don't try to use mine because you won't have any luck. But anyway, so here's a credit card number. You can go, okay, it's 16 things long. That's bigger than 7 ± 2. How do they help us out? You don't have to memorize your credit card, but you have to enter it all the time. I online shop all the time. It's like they give us 4 little chunks. Can you enter into 4 baby piles? Yeah, that makes it a lot easier. Here's the example of the opposite where they don't give you this option. Drives me fucking crazy. It's called your router, the password. Why is it like 25 characters long? It's like, is that a 0 or a O? And it's like microscopic. You can't even read it. It's like, come on. You know, break a brother off with a little bit of like chunking, and then I could make this real, real easy right here. Okay, enough of that. You can also chunk with letters, right? It's like if I chunk this right here, this makes this easier. If I would have broke that up. You know what the other thing that makes it easier? You don't always have to use space. You can use color. And that's where I tell people, if you just write in pencil in your notes and it's all just gray, it's like, I'm sorry, but I'm going to say it this way. You need to gay that shit up. You know what I mean? You can overly gay it where you just got it so sparkly, it's just one big confusing mess, and I do that. But I like scrapbooking, you know what I mean? But the more eccentric or weird I can make my notes, the better it goes into my head instead of just gray pencil. Okay. Okay, the last thing I think I have is this. Can you remember any of those words I just showed you? I probably showed it too fast. But if I show you this list of words really fast, what you might do is remember these first ones. When I show it in class, people remember these more than they remember some at the end. Put on a chart, it would be like this. Table, cloud, book, tree, so on and so forth. People remember these first ones because that's a primacy effect. Later on, we'll talk about this in cognition. Sometimes you get a recency effect where you remember the most recent information that was just shown to you and you forget this because of memory. And recency effects, you go, well, when does that work? I go, sports. Nobody cares if you won game 2 of the season. What they care is if you won the last game, which was the championship game. I mean, my favorite season, I don't want to go off on it, is when the Patriots won all those games and then they lost the Super Bowl. Thank you, Jesus. You know what I mean? It's like, because the whole season was wasted because you lost the last game. Nobody cares about what happened down here. College football is like that too. You can go 11-1, but if you lose the last game heading into the playoffs versus you just lost game one of the season, it's a lot different. Okay, I hope that section made sense. Okay, the third kind is long-term memory. This is the third storage area, and you can't really see my little folders over here, but it's all about putting things into folders because I want it to be there for a long time. And so I have three kinds of long-term memory that I want to talk about, and the first kind is called episodic. When I think of an episodic, I think of this word episode. Like I could have an episode, like I've had several episodes throughout my life. But the other thing is, an episode is a personal thing that happens to me. And so, like if you watch an episode on TV, it's like a segment of those characters' lives. And you might have a memory. So this is personal memories, like a memory of skiing. Now, some memories are stronger than others, and this is where I usually tell my inappropriate story. And here it goes. When I was a little bitty kid, I had just learned to ride a bicycle. I was very excited, so I got my sister Amy and said, "Hey, you get on the back. I'm going to pump you down the street. We're going to go down to my friend's house." So she gets on the back, and I start riding down. I'm so excited. Next thing I know, I hear Amy screaming bloody murder. It's like, oh, snap. What's going on with Amy? I stop the bike. I turn around. There's blood everywhere. Inadvertently, she had gotten her foot caught into the spokes, and it chopped off her big toe, and her big toe is just sitting on the sidewalk. It's like, oh, shit, I'm going to get killed. The first thought in my head was run. I did run, and she ran the other way back home. When they went to the hospital, I went and hid, and my neighbors had to come find me, and I stayed at their house for a while because I was scared. I thought, uh-oh, I've gotten a lot of beatings before, but this is going to be the all-time whipping. Okay. I didn't ever have to commit that to memory. I didn't have to say over and over and over to myself, I better remember this. I could be in old folks home with dementia. It was like, I cut my sister's toe off that one time. I'll remember it, right? But if you ask me what I had for lunch last Tuesday, that's episodic, but I don't remember. Some things like traumatic events burn into your head. And this is why some people don't understand PTSD. Next one, semantics. Semantic is what you do in college most of the time. Book knowledge, facts, definitions, like in anatomy, all the bones. Like you have to remember things. So factual knowledge, book knowledge. The first one was personal memories. And the third one is how to do stuff. Like, can you teach me to tie a tie or change oil or even like, you know, do some kind of karate move? It's like how-to knowledge. And I think we let people down in our school system on this kind of knowledge right here. When we put memories into our long-term memory, we could use maintenance rehearsal. A lot of times with people's name, I just have to repeat it over and over and over. Even at church, it's like, dude, what's that person's name? Oh, it's Maureen, Maureen, Maureen. It's like, that's not the best way for me to remember her name. The same thing for the test or other things you have to remember. I argue you need to use fancy rehearsal. And what is fancy rehearsal? Well, I like advertising theory and branding and everything else. And to me, the best advertising campaign of all time is this one right here. Geico Gecko. Did you know that Geico stands for Government Employee Insurance Company? They could have come out and just repeated that shit over and over and over again, maintenance rehearsal. But no, they use fancy rehearsal and they know it's going to stick in your head even if you don't use that kind of insurance. I mean, flow from Progressive is kind of the same idea. I can get into all these things, and then eventually it becomes iconic, which becomes branding. Okay. Caballo equals horse. I think this is right. I'm a white boy. But if I was taking my Spanish test, I could just repeat this over and over. Caballo equals horse. Caballo equals horse. That's not how Tim studies for the exam. He studies like this. Cab horse. Why am I thinking about a horse and a cab? Because cab horse. When I see that word, cab horse. I don't know. That might seem stupid, but this is how I remember things. How I got a PhD is remembering in kooky ways, not easy ways. And kooky ways are known as mnemonic devices. And so as I use these fancy or kooky ways to remember things, they stick in my head easier. Geico, Gecko. Okay, the first kind of way, mnemonic device or elaborative technique, it's called acronym, and you already know this. We go to SCC, Scottsdale Community College. An acronym is an abbreviation. as far as the test is concerned. Abbreviations that are useful and some that aren't. Laser, is that an abbreviation? Yeah. Light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. Okay, I'm glad we used the abbreviation. Or even scuba, self-contained underwater breathing apparatus. These are both abbreviations. Those first two abbreviations don't seem like they really help us out, but this one helps us out, especially if you're in math class and the teacher gives you this, is that tells you what to do. 2x times 3, there's your 6x squared, so on and so forth, all the way to the last one, 5 times 2 is 10. So I'm able to do the problem. Now, this is for all the conjunctions, ways to join words, fanboy. I don't know if y'all use this, fanboy. I've never heard of anybody that used this one, but it's a way to remember the conjunctions. You know how I remember them? Conjunction, junction, what's your function? Picking up words and putting them together. Or I'm just a bill on Capitol Hill. These are the genius of kid stuff, like with the Diego or Dora. I didn't grow up on this, but all these different ways they're able to teach kids stuff in cute ways instead of like repeating it over and over and over. Maintenance rehearsal. Okay, so number two, acrostics. Acrostics I call cute sentences. The first one was abbreviations, right? So cute sentences, what do I mean? Oh, did you have to take music? I did. In the very first day of piano class, she says, you know how you remember this, Tim? Every good boy does fine. A cute sentence. That says fine over there. You can't see it. Okay, so the other one is face, F-A-C-E. It's on your face, right? So another one, kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. Well, I had to learn this for biology. I could just repeat it over and over to myself, but then I'm going to get mixed up here in the middle. This is the way I got taught. King Philip came over for good soup. Now, I remember kingdom at the first and genus and species at the last because I'm a Homo sapien, but it's came over for class, order, family. Everybody knows that. No, I don't. I just remember this cute sentence. Same thing here with the order of the planets. I don't really remember. I grew up when Pluto was a planet, okay? So I changed this cute sentence. It used to say nine pizzas, but now it says nachos. But my very educated mother just served us nachos. And I can visualize this at the same time, but very educated Venus Earth, it tells me the order too. Now in math, you probably had to use this one. Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. And so it tells you the order of operations right here, but you might have used this. So see, this is an acronym right here, abbreviation. This is an acrostic, a cute sentence. The third mnemonic device or elaborative rehearsal technique is called categorical clustering, but I've already focused in on this one, cluster by schemas. Like when try to remember these 16 names. They weren't very good at these 16 animals when they just repeated them over and over to themselves. Maintenance rehearsal. A group that used a fancier way, more elaborative way of organizing the information, folders, they were better at recalling the information. And this is what I'm going to argue later on you should be doing with your notes. Now, number four, we already talked about as well. I use imagery all the time. So with the cab horse example or the Geico example, just using pictures to help you recall information. That's why I put a lot of pictures on the test. But if we were in class, I would talk about how I remember people's names. A lot of them are just repeat over and over. But the best ones are when we can make a connection with an image. It's like, oh yeah, that's how I'm going to remember that person's name. Okay, that's everything for this section. The rest of the lecture has to do with retrieving information or not retrieving it, really, when you can't retrieve it. Problems with our memory. When I talk about problems with retrieval, I talk about four different words to begin with, but the first two are these. Availability means, is it there? Like if I go to a store, do you have it? It's either there or not there. A lot of times I have to go check in the back, right? Accessibility is how easy is it to get to? So they might have it there, because I'm always like checking availability online, then I'll drive to a store and they're like, we don't have it. It's like, yeah, you do. It's like, you're gonna have to go get it and it's a pain in the ass, right? And so the same thing about your memory. A lot of times it's in your head, but you just can't get it. This is known as the tip of the tongue phenomenon. It's on the tip of your tongue, but you can't remember it. Like in a trivia game. I know, but I can't remember, right? If I ask you a certain actor's name or who sang a certain song, it's like, oh, I know. It's like, yeah, well, tell me. How would you know what's in your head, but you can't know? And so that's a weird phenomenon, right? Okay, then words have to do with remembering things and how accurate we are. So I have this old school Mustang right here. I think it's a 1967. But I love, like, up at the pavilions when they have, like, the muscle car nuts. Reconstructive is if I was going to rebuild this car exactly. And I would argue our memory is never this way. And it's not that we're trying to be bad, but it's just not. We're biased. Like, maybe when I want to reconstruct the car, it's more biased in that, like, well, I want to change the tires and the interior and put a different stereo and steering wheel. Like, you know, it's still a Mustang, but I've tricked it out. So it's not like it was originally. And I argue our memory is like this. It's more biased that we remember things how we want to remember them, not how they actually happen. Or we just, like, I don't know. Or just not perfect. Just think about if you get in a fight with your boyfriend or girlfriend. You both were at the fight. How come your stories are different? You know what I mean? Because it's about constructive. The other area that in is eyewitness testimony. That before DNA testing came about, you know, there was all these people in jail. And then when it came out, like, all these people were getting released. And the only reason they were probably in jail is eyewitness testimony. It wasn't people were trying to put the wrong person in jail. It's just that their memories were kind of faulty. Okay. The other area is memory loss. And if I talk about memory loss, I'm going to talk about amnesia. There's two different kinds, retro and antero. Antero, retro. If something's retro, it's old, right? Retro fashion. And so let's just say I take a hammer and I conk you on the head. This is a bad example, but I just did. If you had retrograde amnesia, it means that you can't remember anything from the past. Old. Retro. You can't remember your name, where you grew up, what your mama's name is, if you have kids, anything. Okay, that's retrograde. Antrograde amnesia is after the hammer hit, I can't make new memories. I remember everything about who I am, where I grew up, but I can't. If you tell me your name, I don't remember it. Over and over and over. Dory has antrograde amnesia. Okay, so that's a different kind of amnesia. I don't know if you watched this old school movie. They remade it, but I love the original. This movie is so amazing, where she gets amnesia, retro, and then he, like, takes advantage of it. Another movie that works on antero, not Dory, but she in 50 First Dates has antero because she doesn't remember him 50 times in a row, right? Okay, that's everything for the lecture. I'll see y'all next time.